गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रेन, स्टे सेफली एट होम. सो आई एम स्टार्टिंग द नेक्स्ट चैप्टर, द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एन एटम एंड बोर्स मॉडल ऑफ बोर्स थियोरी ऑफ हाइड्रोजन एटम. नाउ यू नो, ऑल ऑफ यू नो ऑलरेडी, फर्स्ट जे जे थॉमसन गिव अस द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एन एटम एंड थ्रू हीज फेमस प्लम पुडिंग मॉडल एंड ही टोल्ड द एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ नेगेटिवली चार्ज पार्टिकल इलेक्ट्रॉन, बट ही टोल्ड दैट एज इफ दे आर द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एन एटम इज जस्ट लाइक अ पुडिंग एंड प्लम विद इन इट, मीन्स एज इफ देयर इज अ पॉजिटिवली चार्ज स्फीयर एंड इन बिटवीन द नेगेटिवली चार्ज इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर देयर. But that model was unable to explain the experimental facts. Then Rutherford, with his famous alpha particle scattering experiment, gave us the next model of the structure of an atom. And what is the Rutherford alpha particle scattering experiment? Rutherford took a very thin foil of gold. Then alpha particle, highly energized alpha particle, are allowed to strike the gold foil, and then he observed the movement or the path of the alpha particles after the scattering through the thin gold foil. Then according to the to his observation, he concluded and we got the structure of an atom. So according to Rutherford's alpha particle experiment, all the observations and his conclusion, I am telling point wise. If you are interested, then you just write it down, okay? Otherwise, I am not going to write it on the whiteboard. It will take lots of time. So I am just trying to discuss the observation, each and every observation, and what are the conclusions. Okay, now what was the first Rutherford's observation? First observation was that most of the alpha particle, they move undeviated or they suffer the small angle scattering. So small angle scattering, and most of the alpha particle suffer small angle scattering or remain undeviated. So from this observation, Rutherford concludes that entire space, most of the space within the atom is empty. Alright, then the second observation is that very few alpha particles suffer large angle scattering. So just you try to understand it, that as alpha particle is positively charged particle, so there should be a positively charged particle within the atom, due to repulsion it will suffer a large angle of scattering. Okay, so from this observation, Rutherford concluded that at the center of the atom, positively charged nucleus is present. He told that the entire mass of the atom is concentrated at the center of the atom, and that mass is positively charged. And he told that there are positively charged fundamental particle called as proton inside the nucleus. Then next conclusion, Rutherford, when he made the conclusion, then he applied the Coulomb's law. He told that the alpha particle and the positively charged nucleus present within the atom, they obeys Coulomb's law of electrostatics. Okay, in electrostatics, Coulomb's law was observed or satisfied or followed by the alpha particle and the positively charged nucleus. Then next is Rutherford also performed the experiment with different metals, and he observed different angle of scattering for the alpha particles when he used different metals. And from that, he concluded that the number of positive charges present inside the nucleus are different for different atom. Alright, now these are the conclusions and observation of Rutherford alpha particle scattering experiment. Now if you consider the alpha particle experiment, then from that we can get the concept of distance of closest approach. What is that? Just try to understand it. Suppose there is an alpha particle. Alpha particle is positively charged, and you know what is the charge of alpha particle? Plus 2e. Okay, because alpha particle is the helium nucleus, so it is having 2 proton, 2 neutron. So what is the charge of an alpha particle? 2e. E represents the charge of an electron. Now here, if you consider this is the nucleus, and if Z be the atomic number of the atom or of the metal we are using, then how much positive charge present inside the nucleus, that is plus Z. So look at it. When alpha particle is approaching towards the positively charged nuclear, both are positively charged nuclear. So what the nucleus is doing actually to the alpha particle? Nucleus is repelling. Is that clear? But due to the kinetic energy of the alpha particle, it is moving towards the nucleus. But nucleus is opposing its movement towards it, because the both of them are positively charged particles. They are repelling each other. So what is happening? As a repulsive force acting on the alpha particle, velocity of the alpha particle will reduce. And one time will come when the velocity will become zero. So when the alpha particle will reach here. So let us consider this distance is r. When the alpha particle has reached this point, then the velocity of the alpha particle becomes zero. So what will happen? Momentarily the alpha particle will be at rest. Then after that, what will happen? Under the action of the repulsive force, instead of moving towards the nucleus, alpha particle will move opposite to the, move away from the nucleus. So you see here, this is the smallest distance, okay, to which the alpha particle can approach. And remember that at this point, the kinetic energy of the alpha particle becomes the electrostatic potential energy of the alpha particle at that point, okay. So one can write what is the kinetic energy, what will be the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. Kinetic energy of the alpha particle is given by, so you see, if I consider that r0 be the distance of closest approach, so at that distance the velocity becomes zero. So kinetic energy becomes zero. But do you think that you have destroyed the kinetic energy? No. What happens? Kinetic energy is converted into electrostatic potential energy. So you see, you can write, if kinetic energy of the alpha particle be k, it will be given by electrostatic potential energy. Now you know what is the expression for electrostatic potential energy. I hope you can remember. 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 q1 q2 by r, where r is the distance between the two charge. So here in this case it will be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Now what is q1? Charge of the alpha particle 2e. What is q2? Charge of the nucleus ze, divided by distance of closest approach. So you see, from this relation you are getting what is the distance of closest approach. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught 2ze square divided by k. So this relation you have to remember for solving the numerical, the distance of closest approach of alpha particle towards the positively charged nucleus is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught 2ze square by k. What is k? K is the kinetic energy of the approaching alpha particle. But there are certain drawbacks of Rutherford's model. So what are the drawbacks of Rutherford model? It is important for your exam that it fails to explain the stable structure of an atom. Why? Just try to understand. Now here you see, if you consider the electrons revolving in a circular orbit. And you know, whenever any particle moves in a circular orbit, circular path, then it should have an accelerated motion. So electrons, when they are revolving in the orbit, they are accelerated charge particle. And we know that accelerated charge particle always emit electromagnetic radiation. So you see what will happen. If you consider this is the electron orbiting in the circular orbit, then during its motion it will emit electromagnetic radiation. So as a result it will lose its energy. So when it will lose its energy, then the path of the orbit, radius of of the orbit will become small, smaller, 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 and ultimately it will fall on the nucleus. So the structure of the atom cannot be stable. Once electron will start orbiting, then slowly the radius of the orbit should reduce and the electron ultimately fall on the nucleus according to the Rutherford model. So in Rutherford model, unable to explain the stable structure of the atom, because experimental fact is that the structure of an atom is stable. Electrons, they revolve around its own orbit, and while during their orbital movement, never their radius of the orbit reduces. All right, then second, it fails to explain the formation of line spectrum. If you just analyze the spectra produced by the hydrogen or hydrogen-like structure, then you will see there will be bright lines separated by dark region. All right, that's why it is known as the line spectrum. Now, you see here, according to Rutherford, if this is the case that electrons, when they are evolving, they are considered as the accelerated charge particle, then instead of radiating light of certain frequencies, continuously they will radiate the electromagnetic radiation. That's why the radiation, the spectra formed by the movement of electrons should be a continuous spectrum according to Rutherford model. But what is the experimental observation? That hydrogen and hydrogen like atom, they produce the line spectrum. So the Rutherford's atomic model unable to explain the formation of line spectrum. So these two are the drawbacks of Rutherford's model. That's why Niels Bohr gave us then the structure of the atom, and that is called as the Bohr's theory of hydrogen atom. Now, according to Bohr's first postulate, Bohr said that electron cannot revolve in any orbit. All right, electron will revolve only in those orbit where their angular momentum is integral multiple of h by 2 pi, where h is Planck's constant. All right, so you see, if you consider m be the mass of an electron, v be the speed of an electron in a particular orbit, and r be the radius of the electron, radius of the orbit where the electrons are revolving, then what is the angular momentum? Mvr. So Mvr should be nh by 2 pi, where n may have any value. N is the integer, means n is 1, 2, 3, so on. Is that clear? So this is known as Bohr's quantization condition. This is known as Bohr's quantization condition. Is that clear? Another point you have to understand, that according to this one, that if you consider the first orbit, then n will be 1, second orbit, n2, third orbit, n3, like that. And m is the mass of the electron, v is the speed or velocity of the electron in that particular orbit, r is the radius. So you see, speed and radius, all right, they have certain specific value which should satisfy this condition. Otherwise, electron won't be able to revolve in that particular orbit. These orbits are also known as stationary orbits. Then second postulate of Bohr is that when an electron revolves in a stationary orbit, as I said already in the first postulate of Bohr, Bohr said that the orbit in which electrons satisfy this condition and revolve around the nucleus, that orbits are known as the stationary orbit or stable orbit. And when the electron moves in a stable orbit, stays in a stable orbit or stationary orbit, it do not radiate any energy in spite of their accelerated motion. So the atom remains stable. All right, so this is the main part. This is the second postulate as stated by Bohr, that while revolving in stationary or stable orbits, the electrons do not radiate energy in spite of their acceleration towards the center of the orbit. Hence, the atom remains stable. Alright, so this is the second postulate of Bohr. Then the third postulate is, and according to the third postulate, what happens that if the atom receives some extra energy, then what happens? Electrons in the outer orbit, it may be one electron or it may be more than one electron. What they do that they jump from the lower orbit to the higher energy orbit. And when they jump to the higher energy orbit, they do not stay in the higher energy orbit for longer time. They only stay in the higher energy orbit for 10 to the power minus 8 seconds. And then after that, what they do, they jump to the lower orbit or transfer to the lower orbit, radiating the extra energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation. And if you consider nu be the, this is nu, be the frequency of the electromagnetic radiation emitted by the electron, then h into nu is the energy of the radiation. How much will be the energy of the radiation? The difference between the two orbit where from the electrons is jumping. Just you consider, suppose electron is jumping from this, it is energy level E1 to E2. Is that clear? It has jumped first up. Then it will not stay here. It will again come back to here. When it is coming back here, then it is emitting the extra energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation. So what will be the frequency of the radiation? H nu is equal to E2 minus E1. This is known as Bohr's frequency condition. This is known as Bohr's frequency condition. Alright, so these are the, so what is the Bohr's postulate, actual statement, that when the atom receives energy from outside, then one or more electron leaves its orbit and moves to higher energy orbit. And remember, the electron stays in the higher energy orbit only for 10 to the power minus 8 second. They are like you only. If you get extra money, then what you do? You go outside, you spend the money, eat gupchup, ice cream. And when the money is spent, then you come back to your house. Isn't it? So here also the electron is doing the same. That staying there for 10 to the power minus 8 second and returning back to the lower orbit by radiating the extra energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation. And remember this frequency condition, Bohr's quantization condition, what is that? MVR is equal to NH by 2 pi. And what is Bohr's frequency condition? That if nu be the frequency of the energy radiated, electromagnetic radiation radiated from the electron, then H nu is equal to E2 minus E1. E2 is the energy of the higher orbit and E1 is the energy of the lower orbit. So I request you, please learn all the three postulate of Bohr, especially the Bohr's quantization condition and Bohr's frequency condition. You understand, learn and practice. Now we will apply this Bohr's theory or Bohr's postulate in the hydrogen atom or hydrogen-like atom. What is the meaning of hydrogen-like atom? You know that hydrogen is having one electron. So any atom, if it is having only one electron, then that is known as the hydrogen-like atom. Alright. Just you consider, if you consider a helium atom, from the helium atom, if you take out one electron, then the helium atom will become as a hydrogen-like atom. Hydrogen-like atom means one electron system. Okay, the atom is having only one electron, that is known as the hydrogen-like atom. So let us consider Z be the atomic number of the atom. Then inside the nucleus at the center, how much charge is present? Z into E. And one electron, let us consider revolving around the nucleus. So in this case, if the electron revolving in the circular orbit, then it needs the centripetal force. So, who is providing the necessary centripetal force? That is the electrostatic attraction between attractive force between the nucleus, positively charged nucleus and electron. So if you just substitute their mathematical expression, then what you can write, what is the centripetal force? Mv square by r. And what is the electrostatic force? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Ze into E divided by R square. I hope you can remember, according to Coulomb's law, what is the force? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 by R square, because it is force. So you see what you can do, this one you can cancel. So you are getting mv square is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught z square divided by r. This is equation 1. Alright, now according to Bohr's quantization condition, one can write according to Bohr's quantization condition, what you can write? That the angular momentum of the electron mvr is equal to nh by 2 pi. This is, so now here in this case you can do one thing, this r you can take it to this side. So this is equation 2. Is that clear? So what are you getting? That mvr is nh by 2 pi. This is equation 2. Now if you divide equation 2 by equation 1, there is no space, so I have to rub. Now if you square equation 2 and divide it by equation 1, then you see what is becoming m square v square r square. It will be n square h square by 4 pi square, and divided by this, so 4 pi epsilon naught r will move up and z square down, and on the right side you are getting left side mv square. So on simplification you are getting mr is n square h square epsilon naught divided by pi z square. So you are getting r is equal to n square h square epsilon naught pi m z is. So you see, you can arrange the terms like this. Why? Because h is a constant, epsilon naught constant, pi constant, mass of an electron, charge of an electron, all this entire quantity is a constant. So according to this, you see the radius depends on the number of n, the value of n. That's why we just write it rn. Rn is equal to h square epsilon naught pi m e square n squared by z. So you can, this is the relation you must remember, and then from this relation you can make this conclusion that rn is proportional to n square. Radius of any orbit, okay, it is proportional to the principal quantum number of that orbit. N is known as the principal quantum number of that orbit. And not only that, Rn is inversely proportional to the atomic number of the atom. So these are the two things you must remember to solve conceptual numericals, 1 or 2 marks numericals. Okay, Rn is proportional to n square. Now if you consider hydrogen atom and the first orbit of hydrogen atom, if you consider, then you see what is happening. First orbit means n is 1, so r 1 it will be, and for hydrogen what is the value of z? 1. So you see r 1 you are getting h square epsilon naught pi m into e square, pi m into e square. All right, so this is known as the Bohr's radius, means the radius of the first orbit of hydrogen is known as Bohr's radius, because that value is constant. And if you substitute the values of h, epsilon naught, pi, m, e, and calculation if you do, then R1 value comes 0.53 angstrom. So this value you must remember. Okay, this is a very important concept in physics, that what is the value of the what is Bohr's radius. The radius of the first orbit of hydrogen atom is known as Bohr's radius. And what is its value? Its value is 0.53 angstrom. So you see, for hydrogen atom you can write radius of any orbit, you can calculate from this value. It becomes easier now, because you do not have to remember h, epsilon or m, e separately. You can write rn is 0.53 into n square. Just for example, I am saying, if it is asked that find out the radius of the third orbit of hydrogen, so what will be the third orbit of hydrogen? N will be 3, so it will become 9 into 0.53 angstrom. If it comes that find out the radius of the second orbit of hydrogen, then what to do? Second orbit means n is equal to 2, so it will become 2 square, means 4 into 0.53 angstrom. So that's why this is a very important formula and concept you are supposed to learn and remember, and this one also. Okay, so this is the example, this is the concept of radius of orbit of hydrogen or hydrogen like atom. You can find out the radius of any orbit of hydrogen atom and hydrogen like atom from these three concept or three formulae highlighted within the rectangle. Now you see, you can also calculate from the Bose postulate what will be the velocity of any electron in a stationary orbit. So just consider the Bohr's quantization condition. This was equation 2 in the previous discussion. So mvr is nh by 2 pi. So you see, what will be v? V will be nh by 2 pi m into 1 by r. And now you substitute the expression for r. R was how much? N square h square epsilon naught by pi m z square. So if you substitute and cancel the terms, then what v is coming? V is coming according to this formula. You can write Vn like this, velocity in nth orbit. You see, you can separate the constant 2h epsilon naught, and it is coming z by n. Is that clear? So you have to remember, it is better to remember this formula. So one can say that Vn is inversely proportional to the principal quantum number n, and Vn is directly proportional to z. Just here I am writing so that you can compare and remember. Rn was proportional to n square. Rn was 0.53 n square. Okay. And Rn was inversely proportional to z. You can remember. Okay. But in this case, you see, velocity in any orbit, it is inversely proportional to the n, and it is directly proportional to z. Rn radius is directly proportional to square of n, whereas velocity is inversely proportional to only n. Is that clear? Now, if you consider the velocity of, the first orbit of hydrogen atom, then you see z will become 1, n will become 1. So what will be the velocity of electron in the first orbit of hydrogen atom? E square by 2h epsilon naught, which is constant, and the value is 2.19 into 10 to the power 6 meter per second. Now here, whatever formulae I have written within the rectangle, you are supposed to learn and remember and practice it for your board exam. Now, if you calculate V1 by C is 1 upon 137, and this V1 by C, it is a constant, it is known as fine structure constant, important for one mark question, and it is denoted by the letter alpha. Okay, so what is fine structure constant? Ratio of velocity of electron in the first orbit of hydrogen atom to the speed of light is known as the fine structure constant, and what it is value? 1 by 137 is the value of the fine structure constant. So these are the important point related with the one mark question. You must learn it. Now, next topic is, what will be the energy of an electron in an orbit according to Bohr's postulate? Now, if you consider an electron in an orbit, then due to the motion of the orbit, it will have a kinetic energy, and as it is within the electric field of the positively charged nucleus, so it will also possess electrostatic potential energy. All right. So it has two kind of energy, kinetic energy as well as potential energy. So let us first calculate what is the kinetic energy of the electron. So what will be the kinetic energy of the electron? Half m v square. All right. Now, what is the value of v? I hope you can remember what is the value of v. Z e square divided by n, and it is 2h epsilon naught. So this square. So if you just calculate it, what it is coming? M z square e to the power 4 divided by, it will be 2 to the 4, that means 8 square epsilon naught square n square. Okay, what is the value? It is z half m into z square whole square by 2h epsilon naught into n. Is that clear? Here you see no R is there. Once again, you know that according to this formula that mv square by R is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught z e square divided by R square. So you see according to this formula you are getting mv square is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught z e square by R. So according to that, what will be the kinetic energy of the electron? Mostly we use this. It will be 1 by 8 pi epsilon naught R, and this one is z e square. This is the kinetic energy of the electron. In this expression of the kinetic energy of the electron, R is there, radius of the orbit is there. But in this expression of kinetic energy of electron, no radius of the orbit is there. Only it is in terms of all the constant and z and n. So this is the kinetic energy of the electron in an orbit. Now next is, what is the potential energy of the electron? So it will be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught charge of the first particle, that is the nucleus, plus Z e, then charge of electron minus E divided by R. So you see you are getting 8 minus Z e square by 4 pi epsilon naught R. So what will be the total energy? Total energy, let us consider, is En. It will be kinetic energy plus potential. Kinetic energy plus potential energy. So you see, if you substitute it, you are getting, you can write it as, I am just separating 2 from 8 because it will be similar like potential energy. Half into z square by 4 pi epsilon naught R. Okay, and this one is minus z square 4 pi epsilon naught R. So you see, you can take z square 4 pi epsilon naught R common. So you are getting half minus 1. Half minus 1 is minus half. So it is half into z square divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R. So this is the expression for the total kinetic, total energy of the electron. So if you look at it, it is very much interesting. Actually, the total energy of the electron, it is equal to negative of the kinetic energy. Just look at the kinetic energy, z square by 8 pi epsilon naught. This is also z square but 8 pi epsilon naught R, but with a negative sign. Whereas potential energy, just double of the kinetic energy with a negative sign. That double of the kinetic energy is 1 by 8 and it is 1 by 4, means 2 by 8. Is that clear? So it is coming minus z squared by 4 pi epsilon naught R. So these are the expressions you are supposed to remember. Expression for the kinetic energy, expression for the potential energy, and expression for the total energy of an electron in a stationary orbit. Thank you, girls.